In this figure, we're going to look at the oxygen dissociation curve for hemoglobin. And what we want to do is focus on the degree of unloading that happens at the tissues and how that is at least largely dependent upon the partial pressure of oxygen at those tissues. So once again, we have our percent saturation over here on our y-axis, right? That's the degree to which hemoglobin is bound to oxygen. We have the partial pressures of oxygen down here on the bottom. Now, at a partial pressure of oxygen of about 100, right, that's approximately the alveolar PO2. If we go vertically from here, we find that we are essentially 100% saturated with oxygen, meaning every hemoglobin has, on average, 4 out of 4 sites bound to oxygen. This is ideal. That's maximum saturation. Right? One of the reasons we want to maintain this alveolar PO2 of 100, right? So we can maintain full saturation of our hemoglobin when we leave the pulmonary circuit. Now, when our tissues are at rest, right, they generally have a partial pressure of oxygen in this ballpark range of about 40, right? And so we go vertically from there, approximately equal to 75% saturated. And what that means is that we've gone from 100% saturated to 75% saturated, and that's the equivalent of, again, on average, every hemoglobin unloading a single oxygen of the 4 that it's carrying, right? Unloading 1/4 of the oxygen being carried. What this means is that 3/4 of the oxygen being carried by hemoglobin passes right through the tissues and does not get unloaded. And so, in fact, the hemoglobin is kind of going to 4 bound at the lungs and then to the tissues, go to 3, back to 4 at the lungs, down to 3 when we're at rest. So we have this big, what's called the venous O2 reserve, right? Because it's the oxygen attached to hemoglobin that ends up back in the systemic veins. It was not delivered. So it's a nice reserve for when activity level rises and we need more oxygen. And so here we have our active tissues, again, on average, maybe dropping down to about 20 millimeters of mercury PO2. And again, on average here, we're close to 25% saturated, right? A little bit above, but we can round off for the moment. And what that means is that we've now nearly tripled our delivery of oxygen, right? Again, because our curve is sigmoidal here, because of the cooperativity between the subunits, it's very steep in this range. And so we nearly triple the amount of oxygen being delivered simply by having the partial pressure of oxygen fall at the tissues due to increased use, right? This is ideal. Now, it can get even better than that. One of the things that can happen, and we'll see it in later figures, is that the affinity of hemoglobin will actually fall at the tissues due to the local environment there. In other words, a single curve, the curve in red here, does not characterize both the lungs and the tissues, right? And so we're actually going to see that when we're at the tissues, we're going to end up with a decreased affinity for oxygen of that hemoglobin. One other thing to point out is that during exercise or in active tissues, right? One characterization of active tissues would be during exercise. Another thing that happens is blood flow increases dramatically. So the hemoglobin is dropping off almost 3 times as much, right? But then if the blood is flowing, let's say 3 times as fast, we're having 3 times the amount of blood drop off 3 times the amount of oxygen, which means our O2 delivery has gone up 9-fold. And it can actually get dramatically better than that. So it's important to point out just how effective hemoglobin is and our cardiovascular system is at enhancing oxygen delivery in times of need.